ambulance service. Is the patient breathing?
Starting CPR, male not breathing.
She's in absolute agony.
He keeps vomiting. His condition is worsening.
I've taken some blood and they've come back significantly deranged.
This could be anything.
This is a 12-hour shift with West Midlands Ambulance Service.
Being a paramedic is definitely not a job for the faint-hearted.
Did you remember what happened?
I think you had a seizure.
Every 20 seconds, they receive a call for help.
It's agony, it's absolute agony. There's blood underneath him.
From the 5.6 million people who live here.
Probably the worst day of their life for someone to call an ambulance.
I would say you dislocated your femur.
Filming simultaneously with 8 paramedic crews.
Is there where he's been stabbed?
Potentially in the thigh.
This is what happened when you last had your heart attack.
This is life on the front line.
You're training for the day when you're the person between the patient and their grave.
Good evening, booking on. It's Linda and Gemma.
No problem, thank you. What shift do you want, lovely?
It's 6:30 till 6:30 in the morning.
We're going for coffee, right?
Coffee, dinner.
Dinner.
Food.
Yeah, romantic meal for two.
Yeah. A little candle, tea light candle.
Yeah, we'll go that far.
I'll be lighting a candle.
Oh, well. Right, you ready to go?
Let's go.
Come on, then.
It's 6:30 in the evening, and the paramedics of West Midlands Ambulance Service are gearing up for a 12-hour night shift. As they get going, their thoughts turn to matters otherworldly.
So with everybody going to, like, Mars and stuff nowadays, do you think you'd go?
Who's everybody?
And I'd always basically go and speak to an alien and say, so why don't you visit us ever?
I don't think I'd want to live there, because it looks a bit boring. But I'd definitely, like, just go for a day trip or something.
Would you?
Yeah, just to get out about, yeah, like, yeah.
If they could guarantee I could get back and I'd be fine, I'd go for a holiday.
It's just a little weekend trip to Mars.
Yeah, a weekend away.
Okay.
It's all right, that is.
Ready? I enjoy working with Joe, love it. But whenever we work together, it's normally a massive catch-up shift, isn't it?
Yeah, we talk a lot. It's almost annoying having to go out to patients to interrupt our chats.
I had my first barbecue the other day.
Oh, I know. Where was my invite?
It was very impromptu and it started raining.
I helped you decorate your whole house.
Oh, I know.
You don't even invite me wrong.
Ambulance service, hello please.
Our patrols have come across a male that's unconscious.
Is he breathing normally?
No, not breathing normally.
Okay.
Starting CPR, male not breathing.
So he's not breathing?
Yeah, they're starting CPR.
Thank you for booking on. Just coming through as cardiac arrest CPR in progress.
Did they say CPR in progress?
They did, yeah, and the OM's en route.
A cardiac arrest is the most life-threatening job that we go to. Essentially, that person has died. So with CPR being given and advanced life skills that we give, we still might not bring that person back.
A cardiac arrest may require continuous CPR, so paramedics Mark and Sarah have also been dispatched to help.
8-7. We are already en route.
I believe you would be second crew on scene. LM is arriving,
I've seen
him imminently. Hope to get
an update
before you get there.
Roger, thank you very much.
That's a rapid start to the day.
Yeah. We've got unknown patient, police on scene performing CPR, initial crew responding, us backing up.
It ticks all the boxes for a bad job, really.
Yes, it does, yeah.
The police already here?
Yeah, it's public, isn't it?
Mark and Sarah are still a few minutes away, but Joe and Hannah have just pulled up in Stafford City Centre.
When we arrived, the scene was pretty chaotic. There were police everywhere. Our manager, who's also a paramedic, was there treating the patient.
Is he breathing?
He's got.
Yeah.
He is breathing. 2 rounds of CPR from these guys before he got
Has he had any trauma that we know of?
Not that we're aware of. He might lash out.
As we were putting the pads on, he started to wake up.
Ah, that's Leo!
And become verbally aggressive, which changed our whole approach to the job.
Patient not in cardiac arrest. I repeat, not in cardiac arrest. He's with the police having episodes of respiratory depression.
Potentially, at some point, the patient may have been in cardiac arrest and now wasn't.
It's not quite the emergency Joe and Hannah were expecting, but with the help of Mark and Sarah as backup, they still need to find out why the patient collapsed.
Let's see what we've got. It's outside, isn't it, love?
Here we are, buddy, yeah?
Let's get that stretcher out.
Should we try and put him on his back again there, guys? Just watch that arm, it doesn't...
Come on, buddy.
Mind the arm.
Come on, matey. You're all right. Come here, fella. What have you been up to?
You're all right. You're OK. You're OK.
Hello, mate. You know us, don't you?
It's always a huge relief when a second crew turns up.
All right. Thanks, and it's Sarah.
And on this occasion, Mark and Sarah also happen to know the patient. They could come in and try and defuse the situation, really.
Calm down. Whoa. We're trying to help you, mate. Just calm down.
Because he went from being essentially unconscious to punching, kicking, shouting, being threatening. Do you guys know him quite well?
We know him well, really, really well.
I'm not having it.
All right.
I'm not having it.
As soon as we got to the patient, I recognised him. He's one of our more frequent callers. What have you done to your arm?
This patient is an addict and well known to the ambulance service. Just a few days ago, he needed stitches to a wound on his arm.
No wonder that was a... Oh, my.
No, it's stitched.
What's happened to me?
You've collapsed in the street.
And you've bust your stitches. You've bust your stitches on your arm, outside McDonald's, of all places.
Yeah. Just calm down, you're going to be fine.
Where am I?
Let me just sort this arm out for you.
Let me hold it. Yeah?
Right, mate.
Relax.
Just relax, mate, we're just trying to help you.
That's it, mate.
After a short while in the back of the ambulance, he'd calmed himself right down. He's done this on occasions before now. He doesn't like the fact that we get called out to treat him. But when he gets himself into a drunken state, it's the members of the public who, quite rightly concerned for him, that ring us up.
Can I go home now?
Let us just sort
you
this.
Need that arm re-stitching, fella.
I want to go home.
You can't at the moment, mate.
Although he has no other injuries, the man can't be left on the street, as his wound may become infected.
Don't get upset. Listen, what we're going to do, we're going to pop you up to Stafford Hospital, get your arm sorted, and then you can go home, OK?
We come across quite a few regulars in this job, whether they're mental health, medical, or intoxication. Unfortunately, they are a part and parcel of our job, and we have to try and treat them compassionately and as if it's the first time that we've come across them every time we meet them.
You're going to get you the sandwich at the hospital, do your stitches, and then you can go out.
Yeah.
I'll get you some food.
Check your temperature.
36.2.
35.7. You're wrong. I've got a lot of sympathy for this chap. When are you going to get yourself sorted, mate? Eh?
I wish I could fucking do it tomorrow, but it doesn't work like that.
It's not his fault. He's an addict, and sometimes it gets the worst of him.
How long does it take to get off drugs? How long does it take?
It depends. It can be a
lot. Used to pass your MVQs and nursing.
It can be a long process, mate.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Exactly.
The patient arrives at County Hospital in Stafford, where the wound on his arm will be cleaned and re-stitched.
Well, that was an interesting start to the shift, wasn't it?
It was a bit of a rapid start. Luckily, it was a gent that we know well, very, very well, and it wasn't a cardiac arrest. And hopefully, get some further help that he needs.
Yeah. He's a bit of a lost soul.
I just want that patient to get help. It wasn't a waste of time. It's never a waste of time. We go out and we help people, and that's the job we're paid to do, and that's what we should do.
Shall I see what's next?
Yeah, clear us.
Yeah.
See what we get.
I think us as a team, I think we're like a force to be reckoned with.
Oh, well, let's start making a move, I suppose, might as well.
I think if we get anyone that's trying to mess us about or anything,
yeah,
there's no nonsense.
Chance.
Oh, I can't stop yawning.
And it's only 9 o'clock.
Need to wake up. We're just the A team, obviously,
definitely,
aren't we? Like, totally.
Hello, ambulance service. Is the patient breathing?
Yes, she's in absolute agony, Doug.
Okay.
She is going breathless now, and she's vomiting more and more.
Oh. 4559.
Thank you. Can I pass it to Doug?
Roger received.
Thank you.
Okay, we are going to
Spiddle
for a 53-year-old female who's got some severe abdominal pain, querying that it could be a bit of pancreatitis.
The pancreas is an organ that helps with digestion. Sometimes it can become inflamed, leading to pain and requiring urgent medical treatment.
I wonder if they've suffered with that before, maybe? Kind of know the symptoms, know what's going on.
Pancreatitis, apart from being painful, can be very, very serious. If we do get to the stage where blood pressure becomes dangerously low or heart rate is very, very fast, then that is when it becomes a medical emergency.
Hello.
Sweetheart. Hello. Hi. What do we call you?
Robertina.
53-year-old Robertina, known as Ruby, has lived with pancreatitis for 2 years.
Been coming on for the last few days.
OK, so you kind of know your symptoms, you know what it feels like, and this is pretty much what it feels like, I'm guessing.
Yes.
Right, we'll just get these obs, and then we can see about some pain relief.
Oh, please.
In Stoke.
We'll just get these on.
Paramedic Linda and student paramedic Gemma are with Ruby, who has severe abdominal pain from pancreatitis.
What have you had? Anything or nothing?
Cocoa pulp.
Ruby has already taken a strong painkiller, but it's had little effect.
How long ago was your last sort of flare up?
3 months. Seems to be every 3 months.
Like clockwork, bless you.
Yeah.
When I arrive and see a patient screaming out in pain, it actually makes my heart sink a little bit, because ultimately, you want to make them feel better. But I've got to do a job, and that means I've got to assess the patient before I can just jump in, giving them any medication. And just lift your arm up 1 second.
Oh,
darling. There you go.
It's Jesus.
You just keep yourself focused on that breathing.
Ooh, steady. You okay? Okay. Your anxiety.
Breathe. Come on. Nice deep breath.
Ruth, look at me, okay? In through your nose, out through your mouth. Keep looking at me, look in my eyes, okay? Nice and steady. That's it. Nice and calm. You've got this. Yeah?
It seems that Ruby is having an acute panic attack.
Talk to us. Tell us something interesting.
Linda and Gemma need to calm her down before they can continue her treatment.
Let's try and take your mind off a little bit. Grandkids, tell us about them. Then how many have you got?
9.
Crikey! Nine. See? Loads to talk about then.
Well,
tell
you've
us
got
about
no hobbies.
Hello. They keep me busy.
Are they mostly boys or mostly girls?
Mostly boys.
Mostly boys.
Yeah.
Oh dear.
There's only 2 girls out of
it. Really?
Yeah.
How many kids have you got then?
4. Yeah.
It's a lot easier to help people through sort of panic attacks if we can distract them. I don't know.
Yeah.
Do you find that
yeah.
as well?
Absolutely.
Think
absolutely.
A, t- talking rubbish usually helps us.
I'm really good at that as well. You deal with the pain side and I'll talk the rubbish, and I think we're quite a good team.
Works well, definitely.
Keep looking at me, keep looking at me. Well done. In and back out again, well done.
Now that Ruby's panic attack is subsiding, Linda can give her morphine to help reduce the pain.
That should be started to kick in, yeah? So we'll just give it a moment or two and let it sort of take effect, OK?
Acute pancreatitis is often linked to gallstones or alcohol, but sometimes the cause is unknown. Ruby doesn't know what's responsible for her condition, but treatment will involve a trip to hospital.
Just going to tilt you backwards. Nice and steady. Thankfully, I don't think I've been through quite the same pain that Ruby's been through, but I always try to empathise so that I can put myself in their shoes. Oh, bit of a bump, are you ready? Sorry.
As Ruby is still in severe pain, Linda needs to keep it under control during the journey.
Right, out of 10, where would you score that pain at the moment?
About 7.
About 7. We had Endonox with it last time you had this pain.
Yes.
Did that help as well?
Yeah.
Do you want to give some of that a go?
Please.
Yeah?
Entonox, more commonly known as gas and air, is often used as pain relief during childbirth.
Okay. Take it, we're having a bit of a spasm at the moment.
I'd rather have four kids again than this. Oh. Honestly, that's what it really feels like.
Yeah.
You're actually in labour constantly.
I can't imagine. I've not even had kids, so I can't even compare to that pain for you. I'm sorry.
Well, it's this twice as much. I've had four kids all over again a million times.
As Ruby's pain is so intense, Linda gives her another dose of morphine.
Should hopefully just keep taking that edge off for you a little bit. Where's your name from then? It's unusual, isn't it?
Yeah, I was supposed to be a twin at birth and the brother died.
Oh, I'm sorry.
My mum, she has started
kind of compromised.
By both names, Robert and
Tina. Do you know, I find that really sweet.
Everybody calls him Reuben.
Reuben?
Yeah.
After a 9-mile drive, Gemma and Linda arrive at Royal Stoke University Hospital, where Ruby can be given fluids intravenously to help ease her symptoms.
I really feel for her, actually. It's got to be really painful having, like, pancreatitis. And what with her anxiety on top of it as well.
I liked little breathing exercises we did with her.
Hopefully she can sort of get over this episode and get back on her feet and get back home. And
she was a really nice lady, wasn't she?
She was lovely.
Hanging up the washing today, right? I've got 5 pairs of my boxers. 2 pegs on each pair of boxers.
What?
See the boxer? Oh, I was like, we've got a limited ration of pegs, Bridge.
Back on the road in Stafford, paramedics Joe and Hannah are ready for their next job.
Ambulance services, the patient breathing?
Yes, my husband has severe heart failure.
And he's still conscious at the moment?
He's still conscious at the moment. He's feeling very faint and dizzy, and he keeps vomiting. His condition is worsening.
Oh,
yeah. 906. Thank you. We've had this job patient vomiting coffee grounds, by the looks of it. Pacemaker, low BP heart condition. So we're going to a 78-year-old male who is vomiting coffee grounds.
There aren't actual coffee grounds in the vomit. Someone's bled internally. It's then sat somewhere in the gastrointestinal tract or the stomach, and eventually you'll vomit it out and it looks like coffee grounds because it's old, sort of congealed blood.
Even a small internal bleed, if left untreated, could be life-threatening.
Where are we going? We're going upstairs. And is it your husband?
Yes, it is.
Hi, hello.
Hello, sir. Oh, hello, everyone. I'll stand over here.
I'm Hannah, this is Joe. What's your name?
Ian, I'm Ian.
What's going on then, Ian?
What's going on? Lots. Oh, not a lot.
78-year-old Ian has a history of heart problems. When he began vomiting blood, his wife Penny rang for help.
You're not feeling very well today.
I haven't felt well for a few days.
And have you been sick?
Yeah.
I think what struck us initially when we met Ian was that he looked and appeared quite pale, which is often a sign of something going wrong with the heart.
Penny gives Joe and Hannah details of Ian's medical history.
He has heart failure,
yeah,
which is the left ventricle is not working properly. Today, he's not been feeling well at all, have you? He's been feeling faint and dizzy.
And sick.
And he hasn't eaten very little today. I can't get drink down him at all, so he's totally dehydrated.
Okay. Am I okay to do some observations on you and give
absolutely
you a check over, yeah?
Whatever you wish to do.
Have you got any pain anywhere?
No. No pain. No. Can't help you on that one.
You can't help me on that one. Drop your arm for me, just relax. So I'm just going to stick some dots on you and then do your blood pressure, OK?
Yes, sure.
Let me know if you need to be sick, though, so I can get out of the way. How long have you been married for?
52 years.
Oh, what's the secret?
I'm very tolerant.
52 years is a long time to be married, isn't it?
Yeah.
You said tolerance was the key?
Yeah.
I think compromise is the key.
So because you haven't eaten a lot over the last few days, am I OK to check your blood sugar levels?
Yes.
Yeah. Okay, just going to do your temperature. Lovely. This just shows me your heart.
Yeah. Is it good? Surprising?
So, otherwise? You've got AF, haven't you? The irregular heartbeat.
Yes.
So, at the minute, it's just a bit quick.
AF stands for atrial fibrillation. In Ian's case, it means his heart is beating too fast.
This can be quite dangerous and lead to the patient having a heart attack or a stroke if it's not treated.
If Ian's condition leads to a stroke, the damage caused could be irreversible.
When were you last in hospital for your heart?
Last year. Give you an electrical shock here.
Yeah.
Have you ever been mistaken for anyone famous?
No, I've never been mistaken for one. But I've met loads of famous people when I did my old industry. I met the Sultan Brunei and put him on a runaway mine train and the whole train to himself.
Well, apart from the 8 bodyguards sat behind
him. No, he goes on by on his own. Before becoming a paramedic, I worked in theme parks in Staffordshire and I'd probably still be there now playing with multi-million pound roller coasters and having a laugh, but my career developed into paramedic science that I'm doing today.
Tablet services for patient breathing.
Yeah, I'm a nurse practitioner. We've been out to see this gentleman. We've taken some blood from him and they've come back significantly deranged. I know he did find hospital before.
Deranged blood, severely low magnesium. An 81-year-old bloke. When dealing with patients who don't want to go into hospital, we have to make them aware, yes, you're allowed to make that decision of not going into hospital. However, you have to be fully informed about it. The risks, the benefits, everything else.
Yeah, keys in my hand.
Oh, that's tight. This one here.
Hello.
Is he all right coming in?
Yeah, come on, mate.
So, what's going on then?
The patient is 81-year-old Ernie, a retired coal miner. His son Terry explains why an ambulance was called tonight.
He collapsed, banged his head.
Right.
And apparently some nurses come and saw him this morning and they said his blood pressure's really very low. So another couple have been and they took some bloods off him.
Okay.
And apparently they come back not very good.
Because they're telling us you've got to go into hospital.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know what for.
Your bloods.
Your bloods.
No, don't mean bloody bloods.
Ernie's blood tests show he has low magnesium levels, a substance vital for the normal functioning of nerves, muscles and blood pressure.
You all right just slipping this off for us so we can have a quick look at you?
It keeps going a bit iffy on your legs.
OK. Press that arm down for me. Pop a finger in there. Pop this in here, bud. 36.9, lovely.
What's wrong with me?
Your blood pressure might say something different.
Why?
It's a bit on the low side.
I feel okay.
I know you feel okay, but your bloods are funky.
When a patient's blood results are showing low magnesium, originally they might only have blurry vision, a headache, but eventually low magnesium can lead to cardiac arrest.
It doesn't matter how you feel now. The bloods that are going around you at the minute aren't right.
Patients like Ernie are still convinced that there's nothing wrong with him. We need to keep reassuring him and tell him what the action plan is.
We'd recommend you go in hospital. How's that sound?
No good.
See?
I don't want to go. There's nothing wrong with me.
In the West Midlands, we're following eight paramedic crews simultaneously as they work a typical 12-hour night shift.
Do you feel like you're having palpitations or anything?
No, I just feel unsteady on my feet.
In Lichfield, 78-year-old Ian has been vomiting blood, which looks like old coffee grounds.
We are going to have to take you to hospital.
Yes.
This could be a sign of internal bleeding. Jo and Hannah are also concerned about his rapid heart rate.
Are you ready to go?
I'm ready when you are.
If we didn't get Ian to hospital quickly, his condition might rapidly deteriorate, resulting in a cardiac arrest.
Bit of a bump here. There you go.
OK, I'm just going to attach you back up, OK?
Whoa.
Oh, you've crossed your legs again.
Oh, my gosh. I've been told so many times.
Does your wife tell you?
Yes. Didn't you notice? She's
rough. Joe?
Yeah?
I'm just going to see if I can get a cannula in.
Oh, yeah, do you want a hand? I bet you're used to having cannulas in, are you?
I'm the biggest coward out.
Do you not like needles?
No.
OK. So, sharp scratch?
Yeah.
I think so. And then a bit of pressure, OK. There you go.
Right, I'll see you at the manor.
If you say so, I hope.
Absolutely.
The drive into hospital is only 10 miles, but ex-marketing manager Ian is used to more exotic travel.
So where's the best place you've been? Where would you recommend?
Oh, my gosh. I used to go to South Africa once a year, but chose any of these jobs, what do you see? A lot of airports, a lot of hotels.
Yeah, you don't get a chance to actually enjoy it.
At least in South Africa, we went to Johannesburg and then we were flown up to the mine. And then you're going over some really beautiful country.
Have you ever done a safari?
Yes, I did one in Kenya.
How did you and your wife meet?
You've got a lot of questions there, haven't you?
I am, I'm dead nosy.
Paramedics are generally a bit nosy.
Yeah. I think we're nearly here now.
It fascinates me, especially the older generation.
Yeah.
However, like how they got together, how long they've been married, what the secret is, what their jobs were, because their lives were completely different to ours.
Okay, we're here then, Ian.
Jo and Hannah arrive at Walsall Manor Hospital, where the cardiology team is waiting. They'll investigate why Ian is vomiting blood and what's causing his fast heart rate.
He was really nice.
You can tell he's His wife was quite worried, I think. But I like that they had everything organised. It's always good when they have all the paperwork there ready for you.
Been married like 52 years.
Do you think you could be married for 52 years?
Could you be married for 52 years?
Oh, I'd like to think I could. I think everybody has that dream, don't they, that they'd be together forever and you'd have this happy, long marriage. I think patience is the key, though.
Patience, yeah. You need to get a move on you. Time waits for no woman.
Nearly 40 miles north of Warsaw, in Stoke...
We would obviously strongly recommend that you go with us, because your bloods are out of normal.
Paramedics Adam and Tony are with 81-year-old Ernie, who has very low magnesium levels in his blood. He needs to go to hospital, but he doesn't think that anything is wrong.
But where? How did I late this morning?
Treating the elderly. They seem to think everything's fine, don't they? If it doesn't fall off,
it's working.
Then it's fine.
Yeah. They're just hard as nails, a lot of them. It's the old war generation,
war,
they're used to it.
Pits, farmer, and they just get on with things.
You have the right to refuse.
No, I mean, I've never said that.
Well, I'm bored of refusing.
No, you're not.
Magnesium is crucial to the regulation of blood pressure. Ernie's low levels could explain why he keeps passing out.
Sit nice and still for a second. Check your sugars. You ready? Shot or scratch? 7.7. Ah, that's not bad.
I'm not doing it. Nothing wrong with it,
Teddy. Get his sleeve.
Blood pressure is 84.41. It's on the low end of low.
A normal blood pressure should be around 120. At 84, Ernie's is very low.
I feel great.
You might feel great, but everything else is suggesting you're not.
Did you notice what he says?
It's always good when you get a bit of humour out of a patient, even though they're being a little bit sarky with it, because sometimes it also means you can be a little bit back with them, and sometimes they might break that boundary and you might be able to help them a little bit more. We're going to strongly recommend you come with us to hospital. So you're going to come with us?
I've got to.
Okay, brilliant. It's always a relief when the patient agrees to come to hospital when they initially said they weren't. It's simply because we've already identified he's got something which potentially could hurt him. So if we go to hospital, we know that that will get fixed. All right, let's have some of these wires off you again. Do you feel dizzy at all?
No, no.
Any headache?
I'm perfectly all right. I don't know what I'm doing either.
You're on the charm look after you.
There we go.
As Ernie's blood pressure is low, Adam and Tony don't want him walking to the ambulance in case he collapses.
If he's walking that way, take the bed back on the truck.
But Ernie has other ideas and takes himself off to the bathroom.
If he's up and about, he's not.
Yeah.
Do you want to watch him? Have a posh wee, have a sit down.
While he waits for Ernie, Adam returns to his favourite topic of conversation tonight.
Have you ever been mistaken for anyone famous?
Do you know, funny enough, do you remember Barry off EastEnders?
I can see it now.
I did have to take a second look and I did think, maybe at a distance after you've had a few, maybe. I can't remember ever watching EastEnders with Barry with no top on.
No, I can't either.
Go on, boss. Go on, give us that hand. Grab onto me. Just a bit safer for everybody, that, isn't it?
Shuffle all the way up. There you go.
There you go, Chief.
Yeah. Right. Nice and relaxed. Just need blood pressure.
Are we happy to go, gents?
Ernest, are you ready?
Yeah.
Right. Ready?
OK.
Adam has successfully got his patient onto the ambulance, but Ernie is still adamant that he feels fine.
I don't feel any different.
No, I gathered that. You didn't feel short of breath or anything?
No.
No chest pains?
No.
Yeah, guts all working normally for you?
Yes.
For one reluctant patient, it's a short drive to Royal Stoke University Hospital. Here, doctors will investigate why Ernie has such low levels of magnesium in his blood.
I think Ernie's poolier than he thinks he is.
Yeah.
But he's not willing to listen.
I had a feeling when we walked in initially, he was going to dig his heels in and say no. Oh well. Anyway, Ernie's in a safe place, so let's now go to the next one.
Also in Stoke, Linda and Gemma are now 10 hours into their shift.
Food. I am a single parent, and obviously shift work, long hours, it becomes your life basically.
Are you having anything to eat then?
I'm not fancying my coffee.
Ambulance services, the patient breathing.
Yes. The thing is, he had one of these do's yesterday. He couldn't stand up. His speech was slurred.
Is he experiencing that now?
It isn't now, but it was about 5 minutes ago.
And how old is he, sorry?
He's 79.
There's another job coming up in Patmore, coming through as a CDA. Go and look after him for me.
For you, anything.
Thank you.
Flirting with control.
Always keep him on side. Always keep him on side. So we've got a job for a 79-year-old male who has got some slurred speech. Looks like it's a possible CVA then.
CVA stands for cerebrovascular accident, the medical term for a stroke.
Slurred speech, stroke or TIA, so it's COVID positive, having slight slurred speech, has had these kind of symptoms 2.5 years ago, was took in for a scan, wasn't diagnosed as having a stroke though.
With the information coming through, it did say slurred speech, which is one of the major factors of the person having the stroke, which then turns it into a time-critical job. So we need to get there as quick as we can.
Hello. Which way are we going, sweetheart?
That way, in the bedroom.
Straight through here, yeah?
In Stoke-on-Trent, Linda and Gemma are responding to an urgent call concerning a suspected stroke.
Good morning. Very
Good
early,
morning.
What do we call you, young man?
Everybody calls me Bill.
Hello, Bill.
Hi, Bill.
Tells me you're a William then, are you?
I'm a William.
My name's Linda, this is Gemma.
79-year-old Bill feels weak every time he stands up. Wife Joan is with him.
I'm fine when I'm in bed. I can do anything.
OK. Wonderful. Do anything, eh?
I'm trying to try and get up.
What happens when you try and get up, sweetheart?
My feet go a bit heavy and my legs go... What's it, you know?
I don't know. That's why you're going to tell me. I'm good, but I'm not a mind reader, I'm afraid.
Seeing Bill and seeing that he didn't have any slurred speech or any kind of facial droop, and the fact that he was quite chatty and coherent with us was a big relief.
OK. So, what's made you call at this time in the morning, then, now?
Well, I tried to get up with the toilet.
Right.
Life.
OK.
I tried to go to the toilet and we made a right at it.
OK. Did you feel, like, disorientated? Did you feel sort of dizzy, or...?
Yeah.
But since you've got back in bed, you felt...
I'm fine from in bed.
Was that, like, an instant sort of fix for you?
As soon as I lay down in bed.
Just kind of instantly?
Yeah.
OK. But other than that... You are a young, fit and healthy gentleman.
Hopefully.
I'm ever so sorry, but I'd like to try and sit you up and see if we can see what's going on. Is that OK? I can give you a hand if you need. Come here.
Linda wants to see if there's any difference in Bill's blood pressure when he's sitting up compared to lying down.
How would you feel?
All right, while you were holding me, but once you let go...
So you don't feel like you could hold yourself up?
Well, now let go.
Well, I'm asking. I'm not saying you have to test and watch you fly backwards. Relax this arm, let it go flappy. Are you getting those same symptoms or not?
My head's just a little bit muzzy, but I feel as if I try and get out of my drift.
OK. Ooh, yeah, let's pop you back down. You have got a very significant case of postural hypotension, young man. That means when we are sitting up, when we're standing up, so when our posture is changing, your blood pressure is just plummeting. You were 148 systolic, so the top number of your blood pressure. You've just dropped to 78. So you, young man, have won a trip to hospital, I'm afraid. When patients are suffering with postural hypertension, there's not a great deal we can do to help them because it depends on the cause of it. Sometimes it's due to medication they're already taking or long-term ill health, infections. So we just need to get him to hospital. Right, I've got the stretcher stuck in the doorway now.
But first, Gemma and Linda need to get Bill out of the house, which is easier said than done.
How do you get in through the patio doors? Can you or not?
Oh, my life, that stretcher.
Yeah. I feel like our role doubles up into many forms. On this one, it was removals.
Absolutely. I think if we ever leave the ambulance service, we'd get a job like that.
Yeah, transferable skills.
Yes, in moving people's houses for them. Should we set up a business?
Oh, look at
Perfect.
This.
Perfect.
Why didn't you tell us to come this way the first time?
A different route proves more successful.
There is a little bit of a gap, but you're not going to fall through that gap, I promise you.
You're not that skinny.
Oh, she says the nicest things, doesn't she, eh? There you go. Oh, you're a good egg, you are, aren't you?
That's it.
There, perfect. Was you a dancer back in the day? Shall we have your bag of belongings? Do you want a kiss or anything? Say ta-ra. We won't look. Now, no flirting with the nurses.
That's a bit fun.
Hey, are you ready? Bit of a bump. Locked into place. Going nowhere now, I've got you. Yeah, OK, Gem, thank you. Good to go. What did you do for a living then, young man?
Worked in pots.
OK. What was your role? What did you do?
Casting.
OK.
Pedestals and sinks and toilets.
I think being a paramedic is a privilege. We are going into patients' own homes. We're seeing them at their worst times and even at their best times. And we get to be a massive part of that. How did you meet your good lady?
Walking around and stuff.
Did you? Did you just see her walking by and you thought...
No.
And you never looked back since, eh?
No.
Bill arrives at Royal Stoke University Hospital. Here, doctors will investigate what's causing his blood pressure to drop every time he stands up.
I was expecting on the way to that job with how it came through, but I certainly wasn't expecting a blood pressure drop of quite that significance, to be fair.
I wasn't expecting to have to manoeuvre that stretcher as much as what we did.
Yeah. I'll tell you what, Gemma, I am tired.
I've gone past tiredness a little bit, so I'm going to get home, have a shower, maybe do yoga class, take
what?
The dog.
Did you do like a yoga class on like a Zoom thing or something?
I can do, or I can go to the place. And
oh,
I prefer
okay.
going to the place because wow. if I do it at home on Zoom, I get distracted. Like,
okay.
I'll look at things and I'll see one of the kids' toys under my sofa and I'll be like, for goodness sake, and I have to go and get it. And then that's just my Zen moment kind of ruined.
Bill's blood pressure was tested in hospital, but doctors couldn't work out the cause of his postural hypertension. He was discharged the next day and has not suffered with it since. Ernie was found to have a water infection, which could explain his low magnesium levels. Ian, who'd been vomiting blood and had a very fast heart rate, was kept in hospital for 2 days. He's waiting for a follow-up appointment with a consultant. And Ruby, who lives with chronic pancreatitis, was discharged from hospital after 4 days.
When I got to the hospital, they confirmed it was pancreatitis and they gave me all the medication that I needed then. I can manage my condition like by not drinking, taking my powders and watching what I eat.
Go.
The paramedics were brilliant that night. I mean, as soon as I got into the ambulance, they gave me some pain relief, which helped immediately. You know you're going to be okay, but it's like, oh God, I don't want to go through this again. I do suffer from anxiety and depression as well, so they reassured me and everything was going to be all right. So that was really good.
Next time, a man on drugs has a badly broken arm.
Just going to have a look at this arm, fella.
When you hear the bone is clearly sticking through it, it starts to get a little bit more serious.
Paramedics treat a doorman with a dislocated knee.
Right, suck it in. Hold, slow, breathe out.
There are many ways to try and get a patient's kneecap back into place. We only have one method and we're only allowed one attempt.
And a woman has a life-threatening infection.
You've got, like, some crackles in the bottom and then a wheeze up the top, yeah.
This chest infection she's got could kill her.